umuri muhdathatuha wa kulla muhdathatin bid'ah wa kulla bid'atin dalalah wa kulla dalalatin finnar. Ayuhal ikhwa wal akhawat, my dear brothers and sisters, it is from the things that we should know as it relates to our aqeedah is our belief in the messengers. From the pillars of iman is to believe in Allah and to believe in the angels and to believe in the books and to believe in the messengers and to believe in the last day and to believe in the qadr, the decree, good or bad, easy or difficult. So from our belief is the belief in the rusul, and we know that the messengers, their number is many, and that Allah sent them and he said about them, وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ, for every people I sent a messenger, so that يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ nobody can come and say, Allah, I didn't know, no messenger came for me, no prophet came for me. So Allah said that there is no nation except that we sent to them a prophet, a messenger, a warner. And from these messengers, from our belief about them, is that they are not the same level, which we mentioned before. Some of the messengers are higher than other messengers. And Allah mentions in the Quran, فَاصْبِرْ كَمَا صَبَرَ أُولُو الْعَزْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ وَلَا تَسْتَعْجِلْ لَهُمْ, that messenger and all Muslims, be patient. How? Which kind of patience? Just a mediocre patience? A patience where you complain a lot? No. Be patient like the ulul azmi min ar-rusuli, the messengers who had a high determination. If you were to look in an army, the generals, the captains, that level, those messengers, be patient like them. And who are those messengers? Allah mentions about them, wa idh akhadhna min an-nabiyyin mithaqahum wa minka wa min nuhin wa ibrahim wa musa wa isa ibn maryam. Allah mentioned, when I took a covenant from you messengers, and he mentioned them by name, from you Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from Nuh, from Ibrahim, from Musa, from Isa, these are the highest of the messengers. And we find in Surah Baqarah, Allah also mentions, tilka ar-rusulu faddalna ba'dahum ala ba'd minhum man kallama Allah wa rafa'a ba'dahum darajat, that Allah said that these are the messengers that we have raised, some above others in rank. And we spoke to some of them directly. From these messengers is Isa ibn Maryam. Jesus, Isa, who they call Jesus here, or in English Jesus. And the people have fallen into disagreement and fitna as it relates to this prophet alayhi salam, who was from the highest of the messengers. We find his story in many places in the Quran. From them we find in Surah Baqarah, from them we find in Surah Al-Imran, from them the Surah Maryam, where Allah named the Surah after Maryam, the mother of Isa, as a way of honoring Maryam. But we come and find the people celebrating and mentioning and singing and praising, where the praise is not due and where the belief is wrong, where Allah says he's from the highest messengers, they have in some cases put him way beyond, where they start to say that he's a god, his wonder should be worshipped. Where did the story of Isa ibn Maryam start? Indeed, it started in Surah Al-Imran, when Allah mentions that verily, inna Allah astafa Adam wa Nuha, that verily Allah, he has favored Adam and Nuh and the family of Ibrahim and the family of Imran alal alameen, above everybody else, Allah favored them and chose them. Allah said that their offspring, from them came messengers. Look at Ibrahim, from his offspring Ismail, Ishaq, Yaqub, from his offspring came messengers. So Allah mentions to us the ayah in the Quran, إِذْ قَالَتْ إِمْرَأَةُ عِمْرَانِ رَبِّ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لَكَ مَا فِي بَطْنِي مُحَرَّرًا فَتَقَبَّلْ مِنِّي إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيُّ الْعَلِيمُ. When the wife of Imran was pregnant with the mother of Isa, Maryam alayhi salam, what is the first thing the wife of Imran did? She raised her hands. She said, oh Allah, I am making a vow, another to you, regarding what is in my womb, and that was Maryam. So accept it from me, you are the one who hears and you are the one who knows. This is a point that we should benefit. Let's take a minute. The individual, the lady who is pregnant, or the man who your wife is pregnant, will you pause and take a minute to raise your hands to the sky and to make dua to Allah before you run around trying to get money and get a pram and get a push share and mother care and Amazon Prime? Do you raise your hand and you say, Allah, my wife is pregnant and I want this child to memorize Quran and I want this child to know Arabic and I want this child to teach? Do we do that? Or are we just busy? Oh, I'm going to name it this. In our cultures, if you don't name it this, you name it that. It's a problem. We're going to argue. It's going to cut you off. Who are you inviting to the aqiqah? Who are you not inviting? And it gets worse. The aqiqah will be a big party. It's a DJ coming. And it gets worse and it gets worse. But look at the wife of Imran. Rabbi, inni nadartu laka ma fi batni. How many of us have children and we say, this boy, I'm going to make him memorize Quran. Never mind university. Never mind the secular education. It's good. But how many want to sacrifice and say, I'm going to put my son, my daughter, she has to memorize the Quran? I'm not saying don't put her to school and college and university, but I'm saying, do you favor that over this? Do you prefer the one that is worse over the one that is better than it? That's a point for us to benefit from. The wife of Imran put her hand up and said, oh Allah, I have given you what is in my womb to serve in your deen, to serve in your masjid. And when she said that, she was hoping it would be a boy. She was hoping it would be a male. So some time went past and the baby was born. And as we know in Islam, that the nadhar is permissible to make, that the individual says, I have making a vow that I will do something. I will give £1,000 next year to the masjid fi sabilillah. That's an oath on me. And another, like the scholars, they say, is something that is not wajib, you make it wajib on yourself. So you say, I will do this for the sake of Allah. And that is something that is permissible. And this is perhaps one time we can take a khutbah and do and mention some of the rules and regulations about this. So after some time went by, she gave birth. Naturally, she gave birth. When she gave birth, what did she do? She put her hands up again. Rabbi inni wada'tuha untha. Wallahu a'lamu bima wada'at wa laysa dhakaruka al-untha. She put her hands up again and said, oh Allah, I gave birth, but it's a girl. And Allah said, Allah knew best, more than anyone, that it was a girl, of course. Allah made it a girl. Allah said, Allah knows more than anyone what it was. And Allah said, وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى. And the male is not like the female. The boy is not like the girl. What do they tell us now in the society? They say that they are the same. The boy wear the dress, the girl wear this, the boy wear this, no problem. Don't even say boy and girl. Don't say man, don't say woman, just say person. They say they're the same. In the schools, the young people, they are exposed to the male, dresses like a dress and says to the boy, you can express yourself. The young boy says, I think I'm a female in a man's body, in a boy's body. This is what they want you to believe. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَيْسَ ذَكَرُكَ الْأُنْثَى. The boy is not like the girl. Do I mean that the boy is better and the girl should be oppressed and the girl should be beaten and forced to marry? Did I say that? Every one of them has their rights. The boy has rights and the girl has rights. You parent, treat the boy fairly, treat the girl fairly. Don't oppress the girl at home, make her do all the housework, and the boy, he's here useless, putting his feet up watching TV. Let him clean, let him do the hoover, let him make the bed. The same way, let the girl learn how to do this and that and that. So let there be fairness. Let not the girls think that our daddy loves the boys more. This happens in some societies. The girls, they grow up thinking and seeing, our dad loves the boys more. They're better than us. That should not be happening. The boys have their roles and they have their rights and they have their way to be treated. Likewise, the girls. But as far as your love and your mercy and your time, it should be split between the two equally. So Allah says, and the boy is not like the female. And Allah says, we knew what she had. So she was thinking and was hoping to have a boy so that the boy can serve in the masjid. Nonetheless, she still gave Maryam to serve for the sake of Allah. And like it is mentioned in the tafsir, that Maryam, when she was in the womb of her mother, her father Imran passed away. And Imran was from the high priest, the rabbis at the time in their community. So look at what happened. The people were arguing Who will look after Maryam? Who will look after Maryam? Because her father was a righteous person. So from your acts and your good deeds, inshallah, the good will go to your children. When we find in Suratul Kahf as well, when Khidr and Musa went round the third stop that they made, it was a wall that was about to fall. And Musa was questioning him, saying, these people are being bad to us, they're being mean. They don't want to give us food or shelter. Why do you want to stay in this wall that's falling? Leave it or charge them some money. And Khidr said, this wall, it belongs to two orphans, and wakana abuhuma saliha, and their father was righteous. So don't be lazy, you dad, you mom. Being good and being salih, it will come and find your children. Perhaps somebody does a good deed to them because the father or the mother was good. Perhaps Allah puts barakah in them somewhere because you never used to be absent from the masjid. You used to give sadaqah at the masjid. So let us not always look for a worldly benefit, a worldly reward. Perhaps the good will come. Maybe in your life, maybe in the life of your child. And this is an evidence. When Imran passed away, Maryam, a baby girl, she couldn't say anything. People were fighting over her. Who's going to look after Maryam? And let that be a message for us. We may have relatives who passed away. Let us look after their children. Let us look after their orphans. Let us send what they need. Let us pay for their education. Let us pay for their madrasa. Let us send money to the wife who is there. Let us not just say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, and tomorrow we forgot about them. Like the person said, if you die nowadays, the way people are so selfish, if you die, it's your loss. That's what the person said. Because it's only you who've lost. Nobody will look after your family. If the individual died today, will somebody say, mashallah, he was busy here. Mashallah, he's a good person. We need to put something together and help and make sure the daughter or the son is looked after. Do we look at that? Do we think about that? Yes, we have community members that we have lost here. How many of us, the people who the world fell on them? As time goes by, naturally you start to forget. Let this ayah be a reminder that those people, they are still there. Their children are still there. Their wives are still there. Have we forgotten them? Have we forgotten them? There's a question that we need to ask. So in Surah Al-Imran, Allah says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that he is narrating to him the stories in truth, not hearsay, not false narrations. Allah says, وَمَا كُنْتَ لَدَيْهِمْ إِذْ يُلْقُونَ أَقْلَامَهُمْ. You were not with them when they were drawing lots and they were throwing to see أَيُّهُمْ يَكْفُلُ مَرْيَمْ. Which one of them is going to look after Maryam? This is how eager the people were to take Maryam and look after her. Now, us, maybe you'll stand back and say, okay, let Sheikh take her. No problem. Okay, brother, you go ahead. I'm busy. You know me, I have two children. You go. That's what we might be doing. Those people, they were eager to do good. So the Muslim should be eager to do good. Anyway, Allah decreed that Zakaria was looking after Maryam. As Maryam was growing up and Allah raised her a good raising, as he mentions in the Quran, every time Zakaria enters, he would find with Maryam rizq. Look at the individual who devotes his or her life to serving the masjid of Allah, to serving the worship of Allah. Zakaria would find sustenance and rizq. And Zakaria said, ya Maryam, anni laki hadha, where did you get this type of good food? And some of the scholars, they mentioned that the food that he would find with Maryam, it was out of season. It was not supposed to be there normally, but he would find it with Maryam. So he asked Maryam, where did you get this food? Maryam said, this is min indillah. This is from Allah. So you individual who you are studying, you are a student of knowledge, you want to spend your time studying, you want to spend your time teaching, then know that Allah is the one who gives you rizq. Yes, seek your rizq and walk, but know that Allah is the one who gives you rizq. And I'm going to mention this as a point here today. This masjid here, none of the people who give khutbah or who teach or who are looking after the welfare of the masjid get a salary. Let me make that clear today here. Everybody you see here, they go to work and they come and they do what they can fi sabilillah, and we hope that Allah accepts it from every one of them. Just know that. Because perhaps the shaitan might come to someone and he may think, oh, you know, these people, they take £1,000. You think these people, maybe they take £500. These people, they don't take one penny. And I'm going to say that if nobody else says it. So let that be a lesson for everybody to know. Let that be a lesson for everybody to know. that in this masjid here, we are definitely in need of resource. We are definitely in need of help. And people here, mashallah, may Allah bless them, they are working day and night trying to see where can we get some help, where can we get some sponsorship. So definitely, even if one could argue they are deserving to take something for themselves for the time that they spend here, wallahi, I am witness that nobody takes a pay, a salary for this masjid here, the 6 years that the masjid has been going. So let that be a fact that I want to share with you, my dear brothers and sisters. And let it be an encouragement that everybody should try their best to do their part. Give sadaqah to the masjid. Give cash to the masjid. Do direct debit for the masjid. We have a card reader here. Give to the masjid, fisabilillah, especially in these days. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد. My dear brothers, that is the story of Maryam alayhi salam, who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned that she is from the best woman of this dunya. In all of the time, in all of mankind since Adam was created, this is from the best woman that walked this earth. So one day, while Maryam was alone in her place, a stranger appeared, a strange man appeared. And the first thing that Maryam did when she felt that fear, she said, "A'udhu birrahmani minka in kunta taqiyya." She said, "I seek refuge with you, you stranger. I don't know you. I seek refuge with Allah from you. Stay away from me if you fear Allah." And again, let that be a lesson for the Muslim. You fear something. You are scared of something. You are afraid of someone. Let the first place you run to be to Allah and to mention Allah's name. Because in that place where Maryam was with a stranger, who else could have saved her except Allah? No one. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, through his sunnah, we learn many adhkar for the individual when he steps out of his house, for the individual when the maghrib, the darkness comes, the adhkar that are there, let us learn it. First the parents, then the children. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned that whoever goes to a place and he says, "A'udhu bi kalimatillahi tamma min sharri ma khalaq," no harm will come to him until he leaves that place. Are these things that we do? When we go somewhere, we mention this. When we are scared, we mention this. When we are walking and it's dark and it's a lonely street, do we mention that? Let that be a lesson. When Maryam said that, this was an angel, and the angel said, "Inni rasulu rabbik li ahaba laki ghulaman zakiya." Verily, I am just a messenger from Allah, and I'm just here to give you the good news that you are going to have a child, a son that is pure and righteous. And who was that son? That's none other than Isa alayhi salam, Jesus that they mentioned. In this narration, Allah put the ruh in Maryam and Isa was born a miraculous birth. And in Surah Maryam, it continues about the journey that Maryam took and left her people because she didn't have a partner and she was pregnant. And the people also would look at that in a negative way. So Maryam went and the pains of birth took her to a place where she was sitting against a date palm tree. We take another point of benefit. From the biggest trials that a person has, or even we say a woman has, is this issue of childbirth. While she is struggling to bring the human being into this world, by the permission of Allah, she goes through a lot of pain and a lot of difficulty. So how is it that a young boy grows up or a young girl grows up and what they can do is to disrespect the mom? That's what they can pay her. After 9 months of suffer and pain and struggle and leaving of certain foods that she likes and throwing up and vomiting and not sleeping, the boy grows up or the mom grows up and she curses the mom right in her face. Is that something that is the intellect allows? Is that something the intellect allows? Even never mind, before you get to the deen side, does the intellect allow that a person takes 9 months and sacrifices 9 months for you and almost could have lost her life for you to get your life, and you look at her and you curse her? That's why Allah mentions that don't even say to her, oof. So young boys, young girls, young people, all of us, let us remember the struggle that our parents went through, the struggle that our mothers went through. And let us fear Allah and let us know that what you do will be repaid back to you. If you are one that stands and stares at your mother and insults her, then one day you will be standing there and your children will do the same to you. If you are not one who is beneficial and helpful to your mom, then one day perhaps Allah will reward you with the same. So let us fear Allah as it relates to our mothers. Let us fear Allah as it relates to our mothers. So Maryam was going through this difficulty, and she even said, I wish I was dead and gone before I feel this pain. And Allah said to her that shake this date palm tree and you will get some dates. So drink, fakuli washrabi wa qarri aina. Eat and drink and take some rest and have it easy. And the baby was born, and that was Isa alayhi salam. And this is the story of Isa. Qawlul haq alladhi fihi yamtarun. This is the story of Isa, of truth, that all of them, they disagree about and they celebrate. What started with the birthday of Isa, Christmas Day, Father Christmas, Santa Claus, Christmas tree, public holiday, Boxing Day. It started like this, and I don't know where it got to. But know, my brother and sister, that the basis of it is shirk. Did you hear me in the whole of the story mention that Isa had a father? I didn't. So they attribute that Allah, God, is the father of Isa. And for that reason, they celebrate his birth. And for that reason, how can a Muslim who knows what I just explained now say, okay, no problem, we go to the dinner. No problem. I give you a gift, you give me a gift, because I don't want my neighbor to think I'm weird. But I just explained to you that this is from the worst types of shirk. To mention that Allah has a son, after the narration that I've given you in truth, that Allah took all those ayats in the Quran clarifying, and the Muslim comes and says, Merry Christmas, no problem, Santa Claus, the child sits on Santa Claus' lap. How is that understandable? How? So no, it's not acceptable even to go to the dinner, Christmas dinner at work. And this is not being extreme, my brothers and sisters, listen carefully. It is not permissible to venerate and to respect and to say Merry Christmas, Father Santa Claus, go to the dinner and try to say that it is a light matter. It is not. Let me establish to you that it is not a light matter. Ibrahim alayhi salam, how did his narration start? It started that he did not want to go to the celebration of the mushrikeen. Where did he end up? They threw him into the fire. He did not want to go and celebrate. He could have just said, ah, yalla, let's go, it's just a dinner. I'll just go and come back. Is that what Ibrahim said? Rather, he refused, he smashed the idols, and he got thrown into the hellfire. That's point number one. Point number two, in Surah Al-Kahf that you read every Friday, the young men that were in the cave, the reason they went to the cave is because their city were celebrating a celebration of shirk. And they said, we are not going. And they were after them to kill them and to get them, and they ran away and went to a cave. So I ask you now to say Merry Christmas, Father Christmas, Merry Christmas, go to the dinner, celebrate, or you go to the cave, which one? And many of our people will say, ah, brother, let's just go to the dinner. You know, our intention is okay. Allah ghafur rahim. This is our mindset. Nobody's telling you to go to a cave. All you have to say is, thank you very much, I don't do Christmas. Thank you. That's all you have to say. You have to be strong also. Don't be a Muslim that's just one number, two number, three number at the workplace. They can't tell you a Muslim, not Muslim. Say it to them nicely. Thank you very much for the invite, but you know, we don't do Christmas. Thank you. That's all you have to say. And if they push a bit more, ask them. Like I used to ask them when they say, you have to come to the Christmas dinner, you're going to miss out. I say, no problem. When I have Eid, you come. And they say, what's Eid? I say, that's my point. You don't know Eid, so enjoy yours, I'll enjoy mine. Lakum dinukum waliyadin. This is the country that nobody will tie you up and throw you in a fire. Nobody will put you, make you go to a cave to not go to the Christmas dinner. If you go, you want to go. If you give gifts and take gifts, you want to do it. So don't say that I was forced. But as a way of learning and as a way of teaching, we have to bring this to your attention. If they are having it at the school, tell the teacher, we are Muslim, we don't do Christmas, so that day my child will not participate. Easy. You are not being extremist, my brothers and sisters. You are not being crazy by saying this. This is established in the Quran, where prophets avoided these celebrations. So please, as they are doing their celebrations, which are formed on shirk, protect your tawheed. For the one who wants to hear and understand, may Allah give us guidance and give us benefit. Rabbana ighfir lana dhunubana wa kaffir 'anna sayyi'atina wa tawaffana ma'al abrar. Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana wa hab lana min ladunka rahmatan innaka antal wahhab. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika an nushrika bika shay'an wa nahnu na'lamu wa nastaghfiruka min ma la na'lamu. My brothers and sisters, we have a conference here Saturday, starting after Asr, 2:15 in English. After Asr, there'll be a lecture, and there'll be two more between Maghrib and Isha, and there'll be some food, inshallah. And on Sunday, there will be two lectures again, one after Asr, one after Maghrib in the local languages. Please come. Please, brothers and sisters, be coming and attending and be involved in the masjid. This masjid is not owned by any one person. The same right you have, I have, he has, she has. Brothers and sisters, be involved. And we are trying to make a day, perhaps it will be the next weekend, where we get all the young people, 15, 16, 17, the teenage boys and girls, and we will have a college come here who will explain the options there on apprenticeships. As we try not to go towards these loans, and if you can't take a loan and there's interest and all these problems, there's a college run by some brothers, practicing brothers, and they have some apprenticeships, IT, business. So we will try to facilitate that. Please attend, that's all we are saying. We're not saying pay, just attend and take benefit for yourself and for your family. Ask the questions, inshallah. Jazakumullahu khairan, aqimus salah.